All right. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. Sorry for the delay. We had some technical difficulties. Evidently, Apple does not actually do a great job of like making their devices compatible with everything. So hopefully, that will change in the future. So my name is Jayesh. I'm an iOS developer. But don't worry, I'm not here to talk about iOS. I'm going to talk about something that could be applied to any team, irrespective of their domain and team size. So before I get started, let me talk a little bit about myself. I currently work at Wayfair as a senior iOS engineer in Boston on the card and checkout iOS application. I've been at Wayfair for the last three years, and it's been quite a great and wonderful journey so far. For those of you who don't know what Wayfair is an e-commerce company, and we sell furniture and other home decor items through our online stores. We are headquarters in Boston and other development center in Berlin as well. So what do I do in my spare time? I like to write blog. I actually write about iOS, the web development, which I used to do a few years earlier. Actually, it's an interesting story. At my previous job, I was hired as a web developer, but then I switched my role to become a mobile developer. I usually write about like any place I visit or any interesting food item I make. All right, so let's get started with this talk. So I want to talk about my initial stage, what I was and what I was doing before I became a tech lead. So I was an individual contributor for a long time, around 4 years. And as a part of individual contributor, there were a few things I was doing on a daily basis. For example, I was a part of 2 week sprints where we would add like a bunch of tickets as a bug fix or like feature work, and then we would determine the priorities or when do we want to like release those things. And I never had experience leading a team. That was kind of my main phobiatic factor when I became a tech lead. Because if you don't have experience, how do you actually get started with new thing? However, you want to start at some point. You cannot just say, like, I'm never going to start. But you can learn from other people and then just get started from a few pointers from them. Not being a tech lead actually did not give me like so many pointers about like team directions in the long term. Like, how do we manage priorities? Or what are our team plans for the next few months? Or what our roadmap looks like? Or if you're working on some tickets, why are we doing that? What value does it offer in the long term? So being an individual contributor, you know what you're working on, but a tech lead is actually all about vision and the future plans. And then one day, the transition came to me. At Wayfair, we have like one-on-one weekly meetings with our manager. And in one of those meetings, my manager asked me, hey, are you interested in becoming a tech lead? And I was kind of scared because, you know, I was never a tech lead before. And then I thought, how am I going to give this justice to this new role? Am I going to be compatible or am I going to be a failure? However, you might want to face the things that you're scared of the most. And then after some deliberation, I said, I'm going to accept this challenge. Let's see what happens. And because by becoming a tech lead, I was trying to look beyond the technical domain. Now, this is an important thing when you work with the teams, collaborative work. You're not alone by yourself. There are some people around you who can actually guide you, mentor you, and give some feedback on a daily basis. And that is what happened with me. When I became a tech lead for the first time, I scheduled like a bunch of meetings with like some people who are already acting managers, like senior managers, or like tech leads. So you have to get their feedback and see what is a good point to get started or how you can actually calibrate your behavior and your performance. So first thing I came to know is that you have to shift your mindset. Being the individual contributor, you can like get tickets done, you can like finish your task, which is fine. But then you have to go beyond those things. You have to start thinking in terms of the teams and goals. How can you improve the work for everybody on the team? How you can improve the performance on the team and not on the individual basis? If I do something or if I learn something new, I should share that with the team and I should like let everybody know about that, how it is going to like affect our work in the future. We also want to support for the onboarding and mentoring. There could be a lot of teams or a lot of companies which don't have enough capacity or enough resources for onboarding. But onboarding is a really important part of any team. I remember when I first started my career like 8 years ago, I was a part of this company where they didn't have enough people to like mentor and like coach people. And after 3 months, I was told that you're not actually performing good, like your performance is like below average. And then I realized I didn't actually have a mentor. Like I was doing things, but there was nobody to guide me or like give me some pointers. And by the end of review period, I was told that, hey, you're not doing your good job. So we don't really want to do that as a part of the team. When somebody comes on the team as a new team member, we want to make them comfortable and give them like enough resources as onboarding, give them mentor at least for the first few weeks, and provide them with the source of good documentation. And then another thing I came to know is that communication is the key here. When you work on the team, maybe you might seem that sometimes you are over communicating with the team, that is okay, but under communicating is definitely the anathema for any team performance. And then we want to drive the direction of the team in terms of the goals, the performance, and the objectives we achieve in the long term. So I want to take some time to talk about the goals, because as a tech lead, if you don't have goals, how can you actually plan for things and decide the priorities in the long term? If you don't have goals, you can just like create like bunch of tickets, like start like working on some tasks. But by the end, you can ask yourself, like, what did I achieve in this thing? But if you have goals, you can actually quantify your progress against expected and the actual progress. So when it comes to goals, we want to combine the team productivity with the learning. For example, when a new team member like works on the tickets, and if you feel like, hey, this is like a really tiny task, I can just do that in 5 minutes. But you don't have to say that. You don't have to help them directly. Let them work on that ticket, and maybe while they're finding answers to one question, as they go through those paradigms or those situations by themselves, maybe they can find answers to like 10 more questions, which are not actually obvious in the first place. So you want to make sure they improve the productivity, and even if they take some more time to like work on some task, it is okay because they're learning. They're like new on the team. We also want to increase the transparency on the team. Especially it happens that our iOS team has like 70 developers, and my team has around like 13 developers. So how do you increase the transparency in that sense? What other people are working on? What are their priorities? For those kind of cases, we usually organize like team demos on the weekly basis so that people can know what other teams are working on, and they can ask questions and raise concerns and let their feedback be known to other team members. And then we also want to learn from the previous sprints or the previous task. For example, if you face any blockers, or if you don't have access to like specific information, or for some task all the requirements were not clear, or if you want to like get some better estimation for the tickets, we try to like look back and see what we learned from the previous sprints. Because if bad things happen, that is fine, because sometimes you cannot avoid them. But the best thing that you can do is that you can try to avoid like same mistakes again and again, like learning from the previous mistakes. And then as a tech lead, you might also want to recognize and motivate your team members. Especially for the junior developers, you want to give them some sense of confidence and the protection, like when they work on the team. When they do a good job of like refactoring, writing the first unit test, you can actually recognize them in the team saying, hey, this person has done a great job of like writing this big refactor, which is like a really challenging job. That can actually boost their confidence and can actually motivate them to take on more challenging tasks in the future. So now I'm going to talk about the communication bridge. And this is not a bridge between like developers, but this is more like the bridge between the developers and non-technical people, like the product managers. And this is like one of the main challenges I faced when I became a tech lead. So if you want to like, for example, if you want to refactor the code, and you say, hey, let's refactor this code. But product managers might say, hey, what's the point? Because you're not going to change user-facing functionality. So why to do that? So that is where the communication bridge comes into picture. You have to let them know how it can benefit in the long term, how it can save you a lot of time for the future work development, refactor, or if you want to build a new feature on the top of existing code. So what you want to do is that you have to like convince them how it can increase the user engagement, like product revenue or like app downloads. So when it comes to the communication bridge, you might want to make the translation between the product requirements and technical implementations. Like when somebody tells you, hey, we want to like do this thing this way. So you might want to like let developers know how exactly those requirements translate into a technical implementation. Like, we want to ask questions like, what are the edge cases? Or what happens if this thing happens? Or what happens if the user taps on the button multiple times? What should be the product requirement in that case? Or if we cannot fulfill this requirement, should the app freeze? Should app crash? Or should app display error messaging? So these are some of the questions you might want to ask with respect to all the requirements you get. And then sometimes you get the platform-specific design discrepancies. For example, on the mobile side, sometimes you have like different designs for iOS and Android. So as a tech lead or as a developer, you cannot just say, hey, I get these designs, I'm just going to implement those blindly. You might want to like ask questions saying, hey, these designs do not actually conform to those platforms. Or if you feel like something is not consistent or something doesn't actually translate to like correct user experience, you might want to like raise them to your product manager to let them know how it can actually affect the real customer using your the software. And then one thing I actually use to convince product managers for doing refactor work or any removing tech debts or adding unit tests is that how that work is going to affect the product revenue, because that is what they're mostly concerned with. Like, how can we increase our product revenue in the long term? So when I say, hey, I want to refactor this code, and they might say, hey, why do you want to do that? Hey, you know what? This can actually improve the performance. It can actually reduce the memory usage, or it can actually make our like application faster. Or I know we are going to build this feature in the next 3 months, and if you do this refactor, it is going to save us a lot of time for adding that new feature. If you don't do the refactor, if you already have the garbage code, you are going to add the new code on the top of that garbage code, which is not going to make things simpler. And then, adding to that point, you want to invest some time for the refactoring. Nobody is going to come to you, except for the developers, and say that, hey, we want to reserve some time for the refactors. You want to like motivate that communication, or you might want to convince people saying, hey, I know we have been like taking on a lot of new features, or these are the holiday sales. However, there is some point in the company where you might want to say, hey, this is our freeze time, or we are not going to like work on some new features. So that's a good point to work on some refactoring, and then you can like start rewriting the whole like part of the application or like specific feature. For example, last year we actually refactored the whole card and checkout application, card and checkout part of the iOS application at Wayfair, and it actually increased the revenue by around 10%, which was pretty beneficial. So at Wayfair, being a tech lead, which means you also head your sprint planning meetings, and inside the sprint planning meetings, there are like few things you might want to ask, or you might want to raise, or lead the whole discussion about things. In the sprint planning, you don't have to just sit there and listen to other people. You might want to ask questions, like get some clarification on the requirements and goals. What is expected? What this feature should do? Or what is the customer behavior in this case? Or why are we specifically adding this specific feature? In those meetings, you might also want to include stakeholders from other teams, like the manual QA, designers, the product managers, and in our case, we also include like backend PHP engineers, because some of our features require like support from the backend. And then we can always utilize experiences from the previous sprints, saying, for example, like estimation is a hard problem. If new feature ticket comes to me and somebody asks me to estimate that in the better way, sometimes I might say it is going to take me like 5 days, but I end up taking like just 2 days. Or I might say it is going to take me 3 days, but I end up taking like 10 days, which is not really good because it affects your efficiency. So we can actually fix this problem by saying, hey, you know what? I'm going to compare this ticket with the previous ticket that we finished, and let's see if we can actually better estimate these tickets. So those estimates are not going to be like exactly accurate, but they are going to be as close as possible to the real fact. And then when you make estimations, you have to be conservative and practical. If the person is relatively new on the team, maybe you want to like associate like double the points on the ticket because they need some time to like learn about things. If people are going on a vacation, if they're working on other code reviews or like some of the important meetings, you might also want to factor that time into the total capacity for that specific work. So next part, I'm going to talk about the communication, and it is not similar to the previous communication I talked about, but this is about the communication among the developers. There are like few things we want to pay attention, especially for the bigger teams containing like more than six or seven developers, because everybody is working on their own tickets, and if they like run into any problems, we might just want to know about them, like what's going on, or do you need any help? So consistent communication is a key. For example, if you work on the ticket and if you say, hey, I have this question, and you have like two sources giving you like two different kind of information, you become like confused, which is worse than not getting any answer at all. So make sure there's emphasis on the consistent communication and there's a source or the ground truth for every question that you ask to your team members. When you start working on the new tickets, you might also want to like give the bad news first and good news later. Nobody likes to deliver bad news, which is fine. I like to hear good news first. But delivering bad news is an important part in the planning and progress. For example, if the sprint starts and if I say, hey, I have been assigned like 3 points on this ticket, but I don't think I have enough capacity to work on these 3 points. So this is kind of embarrassing for me, so I'm going to wait until the end of the sprint, which is not really beneficial because by the time you reach the end, people might assume that you have already finished that ticket, but you have not. So that is going to make everybody mad. So even if there is a bad news, let everybody know about that so that they get enough time to reorganize things around. Also ask for clarifications and alternate approaches. Now when somebody gives you requirements, that's not a whole ground truth. There could be like multiple approaches for solving the one problem. You can come to the same solution, but they're like different approaches. Maybe they like take lesser time, they're more performant, or maybe they can give you some learning opportunity. So if you run into those kind of situations, you might also want to consult like product managers or like senior engineers, ask some clarifying questions, asking like, what do you think is the best way to take? Or what do you think is the, how do we like actually make a trade-off between speed, the performance, and time we take to finish this ticket? And then at the end, when sprint ends or like specific part of our workload ends in the after 3 months or like 2 weeks, we do not stop there. But we want to go back and see what exactly we did and how exactly we can actually improve things in the future. Because as I mentioned earlier, if we run into any problems, we want to like look back and see what exactly happened, what was the reason, and how we can solve these problems in the future. So what exactly happens in our retro sessions after sprint ends? We try to look back and try to understand what went wrong and well. So we try to make a list of all the things that went wrong and some of them that actually went well. And then we also try to investigate and analyze blockers. For example, if the endpoint is broken or if our build system is broken, or sometimes the designs are not consistent. And we try to see like, hey, exactly what happened? Or how can we solve the problem? Or if there's a persistent problem, how can we go back and try fixing that before the next sprint starts? And it's just not that, but we also propose what are some of the things that we need to start doing. Because as a team, you don't want to like stay at one point in the long term, but you want to like promote growth and development for the teammates. So for example, we propose like some approaches, like doing the regular code reviews, doing the pair programmings, or sometimes we have this approach, we say that the study abroad, where iOS, Android, or like PHP developers actually get to like work with other teams for a couple of sprints, and they get to know like what technologies they are using, what their workflow looks like, and what exactly their like day-to-day projects they're working on. So for me, like working on the PHP team for like one sprint actually helped me a lot to understand like how exactly they work, what kind of tools they use, which is really beneficial. And then once you have all the action items saying list of all the things that went well, things that did not go well, and things that we should start doing, we prioritize the action items because you cannot like start working on all of those. So what we do is that we try to divide those things into three columns, and each team member gets like vote two things from each column. And then we try to like pick top thing from each column and try to follow up on that for the next sprint. So that was just all the theory. But here I want to give an example of how one of our previous retro sessions looked like. So in this case, we made a list of like some of the few items that we went over. So we had a little carryover from the previous sprint, which is good. That way we can add some more tickets for the future sprints. We also started doing like new things like mid-sprint planning meeting, where we usually talk about like things we are working on, are we facing any blockers? Or sometimes it can happen that I get finished with my tickets early, so I have some downtime. So instead of going back to backlog, I can just ask my teammates saying, hey, you have been assigned like 5 points, but I don't think like you are halfway through that, so you do need any help on that. So mid-sprint planning meeting actually helps us to avoid any surprises by the time you reach to the end. And that way, if you want to deliver any bad news, you can deliver them during those meetings. And sometimes we have code review done faster than usual, which saves a lot of time too. And in this case, we had the three team demos done, which is good for transparency. That way I can know, hey, my teammate is working on like this new feature with the new credit card or like new screen or like new designs, which is awesome. And if I have something to add to that feature, I can like raise those points. However, not all the things go well. In that sprint, we had some ambiguity about deadlines, saying we got like different information about deadlines from two different sources that caused some like deadlines and caused us to like almost miss the deadline before that sprint ended. Also, a lot of tickets were not fully fleshed out. When the ticket comes into sprint, you cannot just make an assumption saying, hey, we don't have this information on this ticket, but don't worry about that. Wait until the middle of the sprint and like somebody's going to take care of that. But most of the time that doesn't happen, and that ticket gets blocked all the time. So that actually derails you from original implementation or original plan. And in the same sprint, we also had some surprise mid-sprint additions, which means sometimes when your branch is ready for the release, some like new bugs resurface. If there is a crash, some performance issues, or some of the feature that we thought that was previously working that got broken. So if those kind of things happen during our release cycle, we don't want to ship them in the production. So we had some like mid-sprint tickets addition in the sprint that actually caused us to not work on the original tickets we added. And then we also made a list of some of the things that we should start doing based on our experiences from the current sprint. For example, we wanted to run the backend team through the mobile app's release document. Because if I say, on the mobile app, I have to release this app on like say specific date, but the backend developer is not exactly sure of like what is the deadline is, maybe they cannot start working on that, or they are not going to prioritize that. So you want to make sure both the teams are on the same page as long as deadlines and priorities are concerned. We also want to make sure the tickets are ready to work on with all the requirements, which is very similar to the previous point I mentioned, that a lot of tickets were not fully fleshed out. So if we don't have requirements, we don't want to add that ticket into current sprint. We want to wait until all the things are ready. Also, we started including the new bug and feature templates, which saves a lot of time, because when you make a new feature, we follow the same and consistent pattern. So why just keep repeating the same information again and again? So somebody started creating these templates that we want developers to like keep using. And new thing is that we also want to start documenting through the code comments. People can make a lot of additions, like new classes, new functions, new method, and nobody can come back. For example, if I write a new function, I can realize what exactly it does. But the new developers look at that, or like if I come back to that function like in 6 months, I may not know what's going on. So we want to enforce this best practice on the developers team, saying, hey, if somebody is doing the code review, we want to make sure you add some enough documentation. So that is all about the theory and some text. But here I'm going to talk about some of the metrics that we created that allowed us to like actually quantify the performance between successive sprints. So before I talk about those metrics, I want to give you some overview of how our tickets look like. So each ticket gets like different attributes, like status, ticket number, and title. For example, if you look at the individual tickets in our sprint board, it could be in progress, it could be in completed, or in QA column. Each ticket also gets like unique number, which allows us to identify that ticket by the unique identifier. Each ticket has a title, the name of the person to whom it has been assigned to. And then there are like 2 days associated with the ticket. The first one is original estimation that people said, hey, I'm going to take like X amount of days, and actually number of days logged on the ticket. So if there is some discrepancy between estimated and logged days, we find out that maybe we did not actually do a great job of estimation. And based on all this information, we started actually creating some new metrics that allowed us to like calculate the performance of each sprint. For example, the accuracy, it says how well we are estimating. It's calculating by dividing estimated points done by consumed points done, which means if I say I'm going to take like 5 points on this ticket, and if I finish this in 2 days, my accuracy suffers even if I finish that ticket 3 days earlier. And if I take like 8 days, that is still worse. So accuracy means how close you are to the original estimation that you made. And then we have the consistency parameter, which says how well we are keeping promises. If you want to add like a bunch of tickets in sprint, that is fine. But I also want to make sure that we are actually able to keep promises. So if I say, hey, you know what? I want to impress everybody. So I'm going to add like 30 points in this sprint, which is not really accurate or like feasible. But if I just like end up finishing 5 points, which is not really good. So we also want to like use consistency to say how well we are keeping promises. Like if I say I'm going to finish 5 points, that is fine as long as I keep that promise. And then we have like some additional parameters like QA, code review, and in progress bottlenecks. And each of these parameters indicate like percentage or the total fraction of the tickets waiting in the current pipeline. For example, QA bottleneck is calculated by dividing estimated points in QA by the end of the sprints by estimated points accepted. And the same applies for the code review and in-progress bottleneck. So based on these percentages, we try to understand how many tickets are waiting in those pipelines and what could be the reason. For example, if we don't have enough code reviewers available on our team, maybe a lot of tickets like end up in the code review pipeline. And then for the next time, we try to get some more reviewers to like remove this bottleneck. Or in the similar fashion, if our QA is on vacation or if we don't have like enough QA capacity, we can always go back and see, hey, this is what happened. So these numbers actually give you some like concrete information, what went wrong and why it went wrong and how you can fix that for the next work. And this is how we utilized all these numbers for measuring performances between successive sprints. The accuracy, consistency, QA, code review, and in-progress bottleneck. For the first sprint, the accuracy was 114%, which is close to 100%. And then the consistency suffered because we had like less than 50% of the tickets finished. And some tickets were waiting in the queue and code review pipeline. In the sprint two, our accuracy improved, but this is not good because we were able to finish the tickets in the half the time that we originally estimated. And then we had a lot of tickets in the QA, code review, and in progress bottleneck. So we learned from like previous sprints. And if you look at the sprint three, a lot of things have changed. Like accuracy is 50%, close to 150%. And the consistency is still 87%, which is good. We were able to finish 87% of the tickets. And in progress bottleneck is only 13%. However, the things went wrong in the sprint four, where the accuracy is more or less close to like previous sprint. And things are like worse if you like look at all the previous sprints. So we went back and we tried to understand like what went wrong. So there were like some things that happened in that sprint. For example, we had some bottleneck on the QA side. The QA had like a lot of tickets to test, especially because that was the holiday season and a lot of teams were finishing their tickets. That's why some tickets were waiting in the QA bottleneck. And then one of our like build machines broke. That actually caused, so even if our work was done, we could not actually merge that ticket into the development branch. So that also caused a lot of tickets to wait in the in-progress bottleneck. And on the code review front, we had a lot of back and forth between like some of the code, especially when people write the code for the first time. You can have like a lot of mistakes done, which is fine. But in those cases, you are going to do a lot of back and forth, which can consume a lot of time. And the same week, the Apple released a new version of Xcode, which is, Xcode is the IDE we use to write iOS applications. And then that caused our builds to break on the local and build machines. That added some extra bottleneck. So what exactly we learned from this sprint matrix? We utilize the statistics to measure the progress and blockers. We try to understand how many percentage of the tickets are waiting in each pipeline. So we learn something from them. We cannot just say, hey, we ended up taking like 10 extra points or like 15 extra points. We actually analyze what went wrong. And then we utilize these numbers in the past sprints, especially for making estimation, saying, hey, I cannot make these accurate estimations, but then I look back at all the previous sprints and see if I can make better estimations. And then we also had the mid-sprint review meeting to avoid surprises. And this is where we encourage developers to give the bad news or like some of the blockers, or they need like some help with the code review or the like technical designs or the architecture. They can always talk to other senior developers. And then in the final PowerPoint presentation, I want to give some final thoughts about the whole process. Coming from the individual contributor and becoming a tech lead, what are some of the things that I learned and some of the things I want to like give as advice? Soft skills and communication matters a lot. Because as an introvert, I wasn't actually comfortable talking to a lot of people, like product managers, like QA people. And especially for the bigger companies, at the same time, you might want to like consult with like 12 or like 15 different people. So communication matters, like you also learn how to write like convincing emails, how to like convert product requirements into like technical specifications, and how you can act as a communication bridge between developers and non-technical people. And then you can always ask for feedback, iterate on that, and refine. Just like everybody else, I get like imposter syndrome. Especially for the first few weeks, I thought that I'm not really doing a good job, so maybe I should just quit right now. However, we usually have like one-on-one meetings with our managers where I usually ask them like, hey, can you look at my performance and can you give me some feedback? If I'm doing okay, is it like below average? And the same things happen with the product managers. You can ask them how you're doing instead of just making assumptions about your own capabilities or your own performance. And then you might also want to learn how to motivate and delegate other people. So you can write a good code, you can write good functions, write some good unit tests, which is fine, but if you're not motivating, delegating, or transforming, like giving that knowledge to someone else, what's the point? So by becoming a tech lead or becoming a mentor, you actually encourage your knowledge to be distributed, keep that in the central repository, make the good documentation, and give other people opportunity to learn something new. For example, if the new bug ticket comes to me, and if I say, hey, I'm going to finish this ticket in like half a day, but you don't want to do that. You want to give it to someone else for whom it can act as a good challenge, and that can give them some like good confidence. So for the junior developers, you cannot just like underestimate them. You can like end up giving them some tickets for changing colors, like fonts, text, but that may not let them get out of their comfort zone. So if you give them some like big refactoring tickets or writing unit tests, maybe they are going to face difficulties in the beginning, but they are not by themselves. There are some tech leads to help, like senior developers, And once they finish those tasks, that can act as a good motivating factor for them to take on some like bigger and bigger tickets in the future. So that's what we want to encourage. And that's all I had to say in this talk. Thank you so much for listening. I'm active on Twitter if you want to follow me there. I also write a blog. And of course, if you have any questions, now is the time.
Yeah. Wait a second.
I just wanted to ask how you deal with the outcomes from the retrospective meetings in a longer period of time. So for example, you use a shitty library and you don't want to use it anymore in the future projects, and how you write it down or how you store those outcomes from the...
So we usually have like tech leads meeting. So there could be like certain things like technical and non-technical matters. But for example, if you're talking about some bad library we have in the code base, we try to get opinion from the other tech leads, like what exactly happened, how it blocked our work, and in the future, is it going to block some other team's work? And we try to like quantify what are the effects, what could be, what are the current effects, and what future effects it can have. And then we try to get everybody's opinion, and if everybody's on the same page, if we can like convince people like why this is really bad, or how removing this library can actually help us like moving forward a little faster. That is what we try to analyze. But when somebody raises any point, we try to understand what went wrong and try to get opinion from other teams or other people who might have experienced the same problem.
Okay, and do you use any decision list? You write it down to not use it in the future, or wrote any pros and cons of those library, for example?
So we have the shared documentation, shared document, where people who actually raise the question gets to like edit the document, and then they let other people to like edit the document as well, saying, "Hey, this is what I want to add." If somebody wants to add some like pros or like some for that library, they can add their own viewpoint. But there is a shared document that we share with other people to follow up.
Okay, thank you.
Any other question?
Okay. Hey. My question is that mostly I have the feeling that is you are mostly focusing on skills and responsibilities of Scrum Master as tech leader, and in my feel that I had question how you manage your hard skills of people that you take care of. Regardless, because I only hear that you taking the assign the task more encouraging to person, but regardless how you manage the other skills, you want to improve the quality of the code in people you take care of.
Mm-hmm. So we had a great documentation about like style that we want to follow. For example, we want to make sure the code is consistent, the code follows best practices, the code undergoes the code review. So we had those documents that we encourage new people to like review. Also, we had the new mentorship programs where each person gets assigned to the mentor in the beginning of their career, and the mentor can actually guide them through the new features or any work they're doing, and that way they can get consistent feedback from the mentors. For example, if I'm the junior developer and if I get started on something, I'm not going to have answers to all the questions, but mentor can act as a good standpoint or the good pointer to like let you know what are the requirements and what are the best practices to follow, or if and they also do the frequent code reviews. That actually helps you to improve the quality of the code. Or you can actually teach them about... So we use a Viper architecture, for example. And we also encourage people to like use that architecture, what are the best practices, and how you can like do those things. So yeah, doing the code reviews, doing the mentorship, maintaining like styles and guideline documents for the best practices. This is how we encourage quality of the code.
Okay, but as code review, the tech leaders are making only the code review, or other person in the teams?
So we have a code reviews channel. So we don't just let one person to do the code review. So if I'm done with my pull request of the code, we post that link to the shared code review channel, and everybody has the opportunity to like look at that code and try to make comments. And that way we have multiple people reviewing code at the same time.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Other question?
Do you have any experience with the pair programming?
Yes, especially it is especially useful for the new person starting on the team. If they write code for the first time, maybe they are going to be like 1,000 like issues. So I try to like sit in side by side with them, and as they're writing code, I give them like live feedback saying, "Hey, you might want to do this thing, or can you give me some reasoning why you're doing this thing?" So pair program is really good for the junior developers, especially when they're new to the team, new to the domain knowledge. And that way, you can save a lot of time while doing the code review, giving direct feedback.
Thank you.
We are out of time, but if you have any more questions, I'll be available around. But thanks for your time. Thank you so much.